Hello and welcome to Podcast Beyond, IGN's number one best and only dedicated PlayStation show. Also the funnest, coolest, and most successful PlayStation show that we do. Did I cover all the bases? I think we did. I'm your host, Brian Altano. With me is Jada Griffin.
Hey, Beyond everybody.
And Mitchell Saltzman.
Beyond.
Beyond. Max Scoville is out sick today. I actually yelled at him about it this morning. Today's my birthday. So thanks, Max, for not showing up for your best friend's birthday party. This sucks, you're bad, and you're in trouble. No, I'm kidding, he's not Brian, doing well, so.
Brian, he's just at home playing the Sandland demo.
Like, yeah, you know what?
He probably is just doing that. I bet he it was an act.
Yeah, he's gonna text me in like an hour and just be like, hey, look at this part I'm on in Dragon's Dogma. I'll be like, hey, check out this work you're not doing at your job today. Speaking of Dragon's Dogma, we're going to talk about that a bit later because we're all playing it, but you two specifically are super obsessed. Mitchell, some of the stuff you've been putting on Twitter has just been hilarious. It really, I've said this before, it feels like this year's, Tears of the Kingdom in terms of just the manifestation of a bunch of weird, crazy, brilliant systems colliding in synchronicity to create wonderful, beautiful chaos. We're also playing Rise of the Ronin, which I jumped back into and found myself completely obsessed with. And then, yeah, the Sandland demo's out. We got to play that. That's really cool. And Jada, you went to GDC and played a whole bunch of stuff that sound like fake video game names, and that's why I love GDC.
They're great.
But, yeah. So let's kick things off with Rise of the Ronin. Now, we touched on this game recently a couple weeks ago. We always knew months and months ago that or years ago, whenever we found out the release dates, that this one was going to get kind of like the short end of the stick, right? It launched the exact same day as Dragon's Dogma. If you look at the player counts on Steam, etc., Dragon's Dogma is clearly the bigger hit. Also got the most review bombs because they snuck in some microtransactions on day one. And then, you know, kind of backpedaled out of that a little bit. But this is a game that I played through the tutorial. I dug it, I put it down, I started Dragon's Dogma, that one grabbed me more, I kept playing it, and then I guess it was like on Friday, I forget who it was, I think I saw, it might have been Greg Miller, was a former IGN editor, current kind of funny, main man, main squeeze over there. Yeah, it's just, you know, Ghostbuster aficionado, a pizza chicken wing guy.
That guy.
He's voted the number one guy most likely to take off his shirt without being asked to, and in fact when constantly being stopped to, he'll do that. So yeah, Greg Miller tweeted about how he's having a fun time running around Rise of the Ronin, how it's an open world game and he's doing all this cool stuff, and like I knew Rise of the Ronin was an open world game and I was excited to get back into it. The tutorial, the beginning is extremely linear, extremely. And it's actually not even remotely indicative of what the rest of the game feels like at all. And so I jumped back in and was like, oh, this is exactly what I want right now. Dragon's Dogma, also obviously massive open world game. It's a little bit more finicky. I will say it's a lot smarter, right? It's probably a lot more sort of like this is a more nuanced way to handle the intricate overlapping systems of an open world game. Dragon's Dogma, extremely sort of like boilerplate Ubisoft open world checklist game with your maps and your icons. And you know what? Good. I love those. I really do. Like they get a bad rap, but like I love a really competent, rock solid open world game that gives you a bunch of fun stuff to do and a bunch of activities and markers to check off. But this one specifically is awesome because the combat is on a level that we don't traditionally see in open world games, right? So yeah, let's just talk about Rise of the Ronin for a bit, why we like it, why it's so fun, why it's grabbing us. Jada, You're crazy for this game right now, right? This is extremely Jada kind of game.
Yeah, it's very much. It's very, you know, it's from Team Ninja, so it's got that parry heavy centric combat that we're used to in Neo and Wolong last year. And you know what? I'm playing it very differently than everybody else. Like I love that there's so many different options for weapons, great swords, pole arms, like you get bayonet rifles that you can fight with. Like it's just over the top with like the amount of options you have. But I went away from all the weapons and I'm just bare knuckle brawling through feudal Japan. I am literally going through and just punching everybody to death or till unconsciousness. I'm having a blast with it. It's a lot of fun. It, they've got like special skills and stuff around it. It takes a little bit longer. There is one of my clips in there. It takes a little bit longer to like get to some of the upgrades and stuff with the going bare knuckle, but you also get a lot of skill points and stuff to upgrade things in your skill tree pretty fast out of it. So
yeah,
I saw the benefits to it. But yeah, I'm really liking it. They've got, like you said, it's got a lot of just like all the goodness of an open world, things you want to do. Yeah, there's me just deflecting arrows mid-air and, you know, punching people with fire. It's great.
That is so cool. Cause like I did a mission the other day that specifically asked me to remove my like level two, you know, or 206 hit or whatever sword, 270 or whatever. I keep dumping points into it. I do this thing where like I find a weapon I really, really love in this game, and then I keep upgrading it. And I had to take all those things off and fight bare knuckle. And I was like, this is fun as hell, but I want to decapitate people. I want, you know, I want all of the, there's like a jank, right? Is that word that it's somewhere between, you know, broken and charming. Right. And I think we talked about this on Beyond a couple of weeks ago in terms of like, it's sort of a term for endearment, and this game has a bit of it. And playing with swords, when you decapitate people, like their heads just fly in completely unexpected directions, diagonally, they shoot up 100 feet in the air, they get stuck in the ceiling, like it's a blast. So I hadn't even thought about like mainlining the whole game with just fists. Like, can you get like rings or anything? Like, I know you can get gauntlets for your hands.
No, so like there's like, yeah, they have like the hand armor. I was really hoping there was like kind of, at least none that I've found, at least I was hoping there was like, you know, like knuckles that you could wear or claws or something that would kind of augment that bare knuckle style. But I haven't found any of that. And I'm like, I don't know, 30, 40 hours into it, like 2/3 of the way through the game.
Yeah.
But you know what? It's very effective. Like, I chipped through people's guard really fast with my melee style. So but yeah, I'm having a blast with it. And the open world, like, I think a lot of people are going to like kind of look at this at a glance and be like, oh, this isn't Ghost of Tsushima, and compare it and like maybe walk away. But yeah, I think they need to kind of look at it from a different avenue. I've been playing this game very stealth oriented or melee oriented, so, and it reminds me a lot of Tenchu Z back on the 360, where it was all about like grappling up to the rooftops and then stealth killing people, dropping down on people like Batman and just taking them out and like trying to get through bases without being noticed. So I'm playing it very differently, I think, than the developers intended, but they gave the tools to do that, which is really cool. It's really allowing you to kind of play it however you want to play it. Like, I still have like the rifle, and I just like, you know, if there's like somebody out of reach that I can't get to, I just pop them with a headshot, and you know, not the most stealthy thing, but for some reason it still works as stealth. Also, I love that I'm running around as like an Owendon, like a freaking like a cheer squad person beating just the mess out of everybody in feudal Japan. It's great.
Mitchell, how about you? Are you jumping in this game at all?
Yeah, I jumped into it, you know, before we got Dragon's Dogma, played maybe like 15 hours or so of it, and then jumped off to go to Dragon's Dogma. And I like it. You know, I might have to fight Jada for it, but I would argue that I'm probably the biggest Team Ninja fan at IGN. You know, Ninja Gaiden Black is one of my favorite games of all time. I reviewed Neo 2, I reviewed Wolong. Like, these games are my lifeblood. I love their approach to combat. I love their approach to pretty much everything other than loot. And the loot is, like, again, the big sticking point in this game, just like it was in Wolong, just like it was in Neo 2. But, you know, other than that, I think I like that you brought up that, you know, these are two open world games, Dragon's Dogma 2 and Rise of the Ronin, that release on the same day, because I feel like they represent two different schools of open world design.
Yes, 100%.
One in Rise of the Ronin, which is very much like that Assassin's Creed style, where, you know, everything is kind of laid out for you. You can go do whatever you want as you see fit. And then you have Dragon's Dogma 2, which is kind of on the other side of it, which is more focused on exploration and discovery and organic kind of, you know, living in this world that they've created. Mm-hmm. And I think both of those styles of games are equally valid, and they should. It's not a case of like one being a, you know, a movement forward for the genre and another being a step back. They both have their own, you know, positives and negatives to them. And Rise of the Ronin absolutely has that. You know, it's the kind of game that you can just go to wherever you want, you know, do a couple of, you know, quests, fast travel quickly back to another area, do another couple things over there. You're building up the world as you do it. And I think that's great. On the downside, you know, you do have that kind, like the world isn't quite as interesting to explore as something like Dragon's Dogma. You don't have those organic discoveries of really exciting things. You kind of know what you're going into when you go to a map marker. But, you know, I think that's, you know, again, it's part of the trade-off there.
Yeah, I think that's extremely well said. I one of the only reasons I think that, like, you know, they're not the only, I'll put it this way, the only thing that they're actually competing in my brain is for time and sort of like the you know, collective, you know, conversational real estate of what it is to be a video game fan right now. Like, I genuinely, and we said this when we first found out these were coming out on the same day, I wish they had given somebody had, you know, that game a chicken. I wish somebody had budged and kicked one down the curb. Because I feel like I'm gravitating more towards Rise of the Ronin right now, just because that's where my headspace is at. I want, I think I don't know if I feel dumb this week or I just want something that's like a little less heady and a little, not necessarily handholdy, but like this feels more like comfort food. Whereas Dragon's Dogma has a bit of like, I've got to learn a new language here, right? Like,
yeah, I know. I 100% agree with you, Brian. Like, I find myself, like, I'll spend a bunch of hours playing Dragon's Dogma, going exploring, really, like, okay, what do I need to do next? Okay, I got this half a letter. What do I do with this? Like, there's no explanation for half the quests in Dragon's Dogma.
Right.
Unless you have a pawn that tells you about it. And so I'll do that, and then sometimes then I'll be like, okay, cool, I figured it out. I kind of don't feel like getting into a big thing like that and figuring out this next big thing. Who do I sell this item to? You know what? I'm gonna play Rise of the Ronin. I'm gonna go knock out some fugitives. I'm gonna go clear a couple zones, just pet some cats, have some great stuff. It's comfort food, like you said. It's a perfect word to kind of describe Rise of the Ronin. And so I 100% agree with that. Like, it's, I'm balancing the two, so I'm not like finished with either, but that's okay with me. I'm enjoying kind of playing them side by side, and just enjoying what they both offer.
Yeah, they I think they both like truly sort of like, you know, tantalize both sides of the brain in very interesting and unique ways. I'm playing Rise of the Ronin with two huge strong swords, and I am just running around and slicing people into pieces. I'm picking fights. I start stealthy. Like, it's like the same way I take over outposts in Far Cry, right? And there's lots of those here. There's lots of like those moments where you're like, you come up on something, it's a red dot on the map, 12 angry men walking around in circles, and you got to kill them all and then take over. And then there's like one big cartoon idiot that you have to destroy. Mm-hmm. And I love that, because they put in these larger than life, you know, this is a game that in many ways sort of like from a pie in the sky view feels sort of grounded in reality. But then you dig in and there is a lot of supernatural elements and a lot of just like straight up goofy stuff too. Mm-hmm. You know, like there are these enemies that you fight that are just like, it looks like a child's drawing of like a pro wrestler from the 80s. You know, it's just like this guy, you're like, proportionally, he doesn't even begin to make sense as a human. But
you're talking about the guys with like the dual axes and stuff.
Yeah,
like
those
that.
Guys yes. are just like, they just look like these weird Paul Bunyan dudes. They look like they walked off of a mini golf course in New Hampshire and they're like ready to kill you. So I love fighting those guys. I love all of that. I'm playing with, my sub weapons are a bow and arrow and a handgun. The bow and arrow, I'll just headshot a guy with a fire arrow from far away, take him out. But the handgun is so comically overpowered in terms of like, you can get like an upgrade for it where you can finish enemies with it. And I love this so much because I will just slice the hell out of a bad guy. And then this red marker will pop up and you hit L2 and you just shoot him in the head with a gun. And it never doesn't feel completely anachronistic. Like, it feels like when, like, there's a guy in that movie Gladiator who's wearing a beeper, you know? Like, you're like, oh, they screwed that up. Or, like, there's, like, a clean canteen in, like, that Timothy Chalamet, or it's, like, that movie Little Women, you know? There's just, like, a water bottle on Game of Thrones. That's what it feels like. I understand that there were guns around during this time, But when you're fighting, you're in a sword fight with some guy who's not really shooting you, and then all of a sudden you just pull out a gun and blow his brains out, and he's like cowering on the floor. It's very funny to me. My other favorite thing to do is there are enemies that throw like fireballs or urns or torches or whatever, some, you know, sort of mechanic to get fire on you. And when that happens, you have, and you get hit, you have to kind of stop, drop, and roll, and roll around a lot, and the fire goes away, which, you know, I hope you guys were paying attention in school. Because otherwise you'd be cooked, literally. But in this game, if you deflect it properly, you get a fire sword. And so all of a sudden your sword just turns into a fire sword. And then you get to slice up the guy who tried to burn you while burning him alive. And I just think that's swell. I think that's beautiful.
I think it's great.
Yeah, I think it's a great thing to do. There's also a lot of humor in this game. And, you know, and again, different ways than Dragon's Dogma has humor. Dragon's Dogma, I think, like, we've seen a lot of the systemic things happening, like a Cyclops will fall and create a bridge and all the men run over his butt. Like, that's very funny. Mm-hmm. There's, you know, the character that he's more overpowered when he's not wearing pants. So you just look at his butt cheeks for 20 hours, whatever it is. This one has some like very silly goofiness to it in terms of like costumes and masks and accessories and stuff like that. Like I got this mask where it's just like an ancient Japanese mask, but the dude's making this like weird whistling screw face, and I put it on my character, and like it just makes me luckier. I get more luck, but then everyone is just like, has in all my cutscenes and everywhere, all these serious moments, I look like a damn fool. And so I think that's really great.
That's a Hyotoko mask.
Yeah, that's exactly.
For fans who might not know what that mask is, if you've watched Demon Slayer, it's like what the blacksmiths wear. So that's like your reference for our audio listeners who haven't jumped into that. No, I 100% agree. I'm running around with a rifle and a flamethrower, which is just also as cartoonish. Like, it's great. I love how just kind of, you know, wild this game can be at times.
Also, the horse in this game is not necessarily like Torrent in Elden Ring fast, where it magically materializes under your ass when at the push of a button, but it's pretty close. Like, it actually, like, you hit the button and your horse, he just shows up ready to rock and roll, and you can do the funny thing where, like, you ride him off of a cliff, you leap off of his back. You pull out your hang glider. Yeah, Yoshi jumping. Exactly. That's the legal term for it. I know, we've been doing it since like the 1994 on the Super Nintendo. Yoshi jump off of his back. He's fine. He's okay. He doesn't really fall in a pit. And then you hang glide to where you need to go. And again, I just think that's great. Does it make sense? Hell no. Is it stupid as hell? Absolutely. Is it a blast? You damn well better believe it is. And so, like, I love that about this game. It's just really giving me, like, all of the fun stuff that I get from playing, you know, it's like a little bit of, you know, Assassin's Creed, a little bit of Far Cry, a little bit of sort of like Tears of the Kingdom, and all the other fun stuff that I love. Like, you get to run around with a bow and arrow and a sword, but you also get a gun and a horse and a hang glider, and you get to take down enemy camps and fight big stupid guys and slice off the heads and burn people alive, and you get to take all your broken, crappy swords to the guy and break them down and turn them into pieces of metal that you can use to upgrade your good sword that you love. And yeah, like, you know, not the smartest systems working together, but it is your typical 7 or 8 out of 10 game that sometimes you just need that. And so, like, I really hope people give this one a shot. I know the Dragon's Dogma is kind of taking up all the air right now, and I completely respect and understand why, but give Rise of the Ronin a chance. If any of the things we just said sound remotely interesting to you, put this one on your radar, put it on your wish list, buy it if it's on sale, or wait for PS Plus or whatever. Like, play this game eventually in your life, because life is short and you should play games like this.
And I would love to see any of our listeners take my top scores at any of the firing ranges. I have the top score in the firing ranges for the first two locations. I haven't checked it since this last weekend, but I had them for a while, so I gotta go and check. But I had some good, like, breakaways on some of them. I also love just how many firing ranges there are, and they're different at each one. Like, the one we're showing right now, you get like a little minigun, a Gatling gun to kind of go through at start. There's one with a cannon. There's a whole bunch of different ones. They're different at everything. So that's one thing I love. I love being able to just finesse my, or just demonstrate my finesse with like ranged weapons and target ranges. And so, like, that was one thing I was like, oh, I'm hooked on this game, because I just got to get to the next firing range.
If I was ever to make a, if I was ever to design a game and wanted Jada to play it, this I know insane. That all I have to do is just put a firing range in it.
I know. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Jada, like, you were absolutely nasty at the RE4 remake firing range. And, like, I'm so bad at that. And I hate that because I'm so good at that game. And I've, mm-hmm. I've, like, expertly crushed through every other thing in it. And that was the one where I was like, Mom, can you help me get the trophy? Like, it's just like, I just can't. Like, this, there's always those things on open world games where it's always, like, racing challenges and firing range mm-hmm. stuff where I'm like, well, I'm never going to 100% that. And then I look at you and you're like, yeah, here's me with the turret gun. And
like, those are like my two best things in games. Like, I'm actually wicked in racing games, but like, mm-hmm. I just don't enjoy them. I get bored of them really quickly. So like, I'm still waiting for that racing game to like hook me and keep me playing forever. But
this, I mean, this is not even like you're playing this on console. This is not like yep. mouse and keyboard. Yes. This is. It, yeah, insane. So yeah, that's an option. If you want to beat Jada's high scores, go do that. I won't. I'm bad at that. Jada, we should go to like a real shooting range one day, and then we'll do the thing where we hold up our paper targets at the end, and mine's like just in a full circle around the guy's head, and you're like, I got a perfect headshot on him 60 times in a row.
I gotta find one. I went to a firing range a couple years ago, and that's basically what my target. It wasn't headshots, but it was all center mass, like.
Oh my
like
god.
Within centimeters of each other. Like I'm actually pretty good with a handgun. I haven't tried anything higher caliber yet, but that's next on the list.
Dangerous. I'm terrified. I'm glad we're friends.
Yeah, you know, zombie apocalypse. Gotta have a reason to recruit me, right?
Yeah, no, I'm calling you first, for sure.
I'm expecting you to play your part as well.
All right, let's hop over to Dragon's Dogma. Obviously, the bigger game, the more successful game, the more popular game, but also the one that is, I think, creating the most sort of interesting stories coming out of it. Mitchell, like some of the stuff you've been putting on Twitter has just been amazing. It's doing that thing that I think a great open world game does, where it sells people on it more than any commercial ever could. You could pay influencers and graphic designers and marketers and video companies to cut trailers and promos and all of that. And then there's just like, hey, my friend put a clip on Twitter and I'm like, oh yeah, I got to play that this afternoon. So tell me about your adventures in Dragon's Dogma right now. How are you liking the game?
I love it. I keep telling people, I feel like it's an imperfect masterpiece. It would absolutely be one of my favorite games of all time if it wasn't for like a handful of like really significant things. But like I always think that the tell of a really great open world is the ability to have a story that you can tell a friend about, of something that happened to you that no one else is gonna have. Like that's your story. And yeah, this game is full of that. You can see that on Twitter of like, you know, people who boarded an ox cart, and as soon as you know, the ox cart was about to leave, a griffin comes down and destroys the ox cart. And now you're in a fight with a griffin and you're just trying to get to, you know, this one town. Or, you know, you're fighting an ogre and then all of a sudden a cyclops joins the battle and now you're fighting two giant monsters. It's just there's so many interesting things that can happen in the sandbox of this world. And yeah, it's just absolutely incredible in that way. I've never really played a game quite like that. Breath of the Wild comes close, Elden Ring comes close, but mm-hmm. in terms of like those emergent crazy stories that can come up in this game, I can't think of another game that you know that can top it.
I love that early in this game they teach you to pick up a rock and throw it, and you're like, well, what am I going to use that for? And then it turns out to be like a ton of things. I was texting with my friend Mitch Dyer, who former IGN editor. I never would have predicted that in my, you know, winter years at this age, I'd have multiple friends named Mitch. It's such a, you know, specific name.
There are dozens of us.
And he said that like he did this quest where like there was this like really bad king who turned out to be racist, and he killed him and then carried his body to the sea and just threw him in. And I'm like, I love that. Max was texting me yesterday saying like he's stuck on this part where he like tried to sneak around an area he was in and cut through this super high level area where all these like little trolls just won't let him go by, and no matter what they just keep killing him. And I'm like, dude, I'm sorry. This sounds frustrating, and I know you're out sick right now, but I can't stop laughing at that. Like, it's the idea of you, especially because, like, you're the tallest guy I know, and you're just getting your ass kicked by all these, like, little trolls.
I was in a gondola or, like, a ropeway or whatever going. It was the slowest ropeway in the world, and I was getting literally pecked to death by a harpy, and I had a pawn that wasn't mine. It was someone that I hired. I was just sitting there watching it peck my face off. And as soon as I killed the harpy, I just yeeted that pawn off the rope. I'm like, all right, get out of here.
Oh my God. So yeah, you were like, you didn't stick up for me.
Yep.
Did you see the video of the pawn catching a, it went viral the other day. It was like somebody fell off a thing and a pawn was like, I got you, and saved them.
I saw a clip of this guy whose his cautionary tale was, please give your pawns one attack, like actual damaging attack, because he got snagged by a wolf and the wolf just carried him off like 100 yards, and then like 3 or 4 more wolves came in and started gnawing on him on this rock, and the pawn comes over and is just healing him. Like, that's all the pawn was doing. It's just the slow heal of him being ripped to shreds and his body being put back together just nonstop for like 2 minutes. And I'm just like, oh man, that is terrible.
That's what a Sisyphean torture that is too. Imagine being that pawn and you're like, surely you're here to stop the people from killing me, right? And you're like, no, I want you to feel the pain of wolves eating you for hours. I'm gonna keep this prolonged as long as possible.
Go ahead, Jada.
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
I was just gonna say it's things like that where, like, you know, the pawns aren't perfect. They can be stupid oftentimes. They're not quite as stupid as the first game where, like, they would just jump off cliffs for no reason.
Mine still do.
But you know, they're imperfect, and that's part of their charm, I think, because it helps lead to some of these crazy moments that, you know, even if you end up dying or having to retry a little bit, the fact that you got to experience that is something that is worth a lot to me.
Yeah.
I agree. It's very unique to Dragon's Dogma. You know, to Mitchell's your point earlier about how, like, Tears of the Kingdom and Elden Ring come very close to it. I think one thing that that Dragon's Dogma has over it is the fact that, yes, there's monsters that are generally live in certain locales, but, like, random ones can appear just about anywhere. Whereas, like, Elden Ring, it's very set. You know, these monsters are going to always spawn here. Every time you hit a checkpoint, they're always going to spawn here. Mm-hmm. So you know what to expect. Tears of the Kingdom, there's some, like, roaming enemies, but for the most part, they're like, hey, they're always going to be in these areas. Dragon's Dogma kind of throws that away. It's like, hey, I've ran across this road 8 times and there's been goblins here, but this time there's 2 ogres. Okay, that's cool. Let me just fight these 2 things while protecting this ox cart, because also ox carts suck. I was trying to finish some work yesterday and I was like, okay, you know what? I'm gonna just set my ox cart to go to this location, and by the time it gets there, because it's very slow, I'll be done writing this thing, this document up. And which it, I kid you not, 5 times in the exact same location, enemies came and destroyed my ox cart in the same exact location. And it was different enemies every time.
When Henry Ford announced the beginning of the automobile industry, that's what he said. He's like, ox carts suck. These Griffins keep breaking mine. We need a car. We need something. We need something better. Capcom announced yesterday that there are some patches coming to the game. It's sort of a moving target, right? Like, I won't say it like came in a little hot and heavy, but there was definitely some things that were like on launch day. Specifically, the way the game handles save files is really interesting, and it's likely getting rectified. You'll be able to start a new game even though you have a save file already. I believe currently that your save file is tied to your PSN ID. It's like one per console, basically, like for how you're playing online. And the other thing they're doing is they're adjusting sort of the frame rate cap stuff. And one thing that was really funny about that we reported on last week was that players, I believe on PC, were murdering NPCs all over the map to free up RAM so that the game would run better. And so if they patch that now, hopefully those NPCs will stay, they'll get to live their lives as is. Because I think that's just not fair.
I mean, I mean, I'm in the quest right now to nuke an entire town with this Dragon's Plague. I don't know if you've heard about this, Brian.
Mm-hmm. To be clear, not a quest.
It's not a quest at all.
Jada doing her own thing.
I was reading about the Dragon's Plague thing yesterday. So that is a disease that exists in the game that isn't outright explained, but it's your characters will develop like weird eyes, and it means mm-hmm. that they caught like Dragon's Dogma COVID or whatever. Like what?
Yeah.
What? Tell me about this fake disease in this game.
Yeah. So I mean, there's a tooltip that pops up if you ever get a pawn that has Dragon's Plague.
Okay.
But
it's called the sword. You chop his head off. You move on with your life. Yeah.
But you don't. There's. It doesn't appear on a status page. So you can't like look at it and see if somebody has it. The only thing you can do is like really pay attention to your pawns. You have to look at them and listen to them. Because they'll eventually, if they have it, they'll develop these like bright red eyes, which I got a pawn yesterday that had it, and I gave that pawn ID to Mitchell, who recruited it and sent me a picture, and he's like, nope, she's fine in my world, just bright blue eyes, totally normal. But in my world, she had the Dragon's Plague. And this happens generally, like so far from what we've been able to ascertain, is if you hire a pawn that's way above your level. In my case, I was level 30 and I hired a level 48 pawn just to see if I could get the Dragon's Plague. And they'll start complaining about headaches. They'll start like disobeying orders. They won't listen to you, do a whole bunch of other stuff. And then if you don't treat it, which is by, you know, hurling them into the brine or decapitating them or dismissing them, however you feel like getting rid of them.
So wait, so I was joking before. The only way to treat it is by killing them?
Basically, yeah. or dismissing them back into the rift. If you don't, eventually after you rest at an inn, they'll transform into a dragon and blow up a town. And including all of the NPCs and story NPCs and stuff like that. So
seems bad.
It's really there just to kind of bork your game.
I'm sorry, that is so funny.
It's like great.
It sounds like a pain in the ass, but it's also like that's such a funny idea for a thing to put into a video game.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I feel like if you just hear that and you don't have a frame of reference of like how much has to go wrong for you to actually get to that point, that probably sounds like it's maybe a little extreme, but I think it's great. I think. You know, this game, Hideaki Itsuno, is big on consequences for your actions. Mm-hmm. It's the reason why there's one save. It's the reason why, you know, if you answer a Sphinx's riddle and you get it wrong, you know, you don't get that reward. Sorry.
Right.
Unless you do some clever cloud save scumming, that, you know, you lock yourself out of that reward. I feel like games should be able to have consequences like that.
I agree. I think it's like we talked a lot about Rise of the Ronin before. I think it's like extremely, first of all, like that game has difficulty settings. It's got accessibility mm-hmm. settings in terms of like parry times and all this other stuff. But also like you can totally save scum in that game. Like I did this thing where I walked into a gambling den and saved right before and then won and then saved after. And then I just did that like a bunch of times in a row. And I'm like, yeah, this is cheating, but like, you know, gamblers historically love cheating, so fine, whatever. But I agree with you, Mitchell. Like, not every game needs to be extremely handholdy. I think it's good that a lot of them are, but for a game like this, like, you know, he's obviously designed the game around the idea of like, you have one life to live. Make the decisions that you make. Things could go bad. Things could go great. They might not go your way. Your pawn might stand in fire for 10 minutes and die, or get a disease and turn into a dragon and blow you up. But deal with it, you know, and when you're done, maybe re-roll and try again.
Yep.
Yeah, and also, you know, there is a balance to it, because you don't want to make the experience miserable for the player for the sake of those consequences.
Right.
And to that extent, you know, the autosave is very good. One of the things I really like about this game that doesn't really get talked about a lot is that the autosave is fairly generous. Like, if you die right before a big ogre or big cyclops, you'll be able to respawn right before the fight, and you can either decide whether you want to try again or get the heck away. You're never stuck like in a fight if you don't want to be.
Right.
And then if you, for whatever reason, something happens and you're just in a really bad autosave, then, you know, you have the you know, reload at the last in. And at that point, you just have to be good about saving at ins.
Yeah.
Because the first game, one of my biggest problems with the first game was that it kind of relied on manual saves. And if you forgot to manual save and you all of a sudden get one-shotted while wandering in the wilderness, you know.
Especially at night where you can't see anything.
Exactly. Right. It was a problem in Dragon's Dogma 2, in Dragon's Dogma 1, and I'm glad that, you know, they figured out a way to get around that while still, you know, keeping true to this idea of, like, actions have consequences.
Yes, yeah. I think that, like, what's important about that is that sort of, like, on a structural, systemic level, our consoles have become a lot more sort of liberal in terms of, like, not necessarily handholding, but having systems in place, like, you know, sleep mode and quick resume and cloud saves and all this other stuff. And so, like, if you have a game that doesn't adhere to any of those rules in 2024, and the language you've taught the consumer and the player is to expect those things to work, then you have a clash, right? And I'm glad that they found a middle ground between being like, okay, this is, you know, this is a little wonky and it's a little screwy and, like, you know, it is a little, you have one life to live, but also, like, there is an autosave. We got your back over here. That's the, you know, it's not completely designed to get you. There are games that, like, you know, have permadeath for characters and stuff like that, or permadeath modes and stuff like that. And that is, you know, by design, by philosophy. Like, even if you look at stuff like Elden Ring, that is definitely, like, them taking years of Souls-like games and, you know, funneling them into a way that's like, well, you can play this in a way that's very difficult, but also we've removed some of the barriers for people without straight up giving you an easy mode. So yeah, it's really interesting to see how game design philosophy evolves over the years while still sort of, like, maintaining what it wants to be at its core, and you know, making something that for contemporary gamers, they can not want to uninstall it and get a refund just because one bad day happens to them. Because that will happen. Like, you will have a bad day in Dragon's Dogma. It will kick your ass. Yeah. Like, your friends will get hurt or drown or burn, and your whole crew will get taken out.
You don't drown in Dragon's Dogma. You get taken by the brine and ripped apart as you get pulled into the ocean.
Mm-hmm. I figured that out very early on, where I was like, I can jump off this cliff into that beautiful lake. What a beautiful lake. And after playing so many open world games, I'm like, I could definitely go in there. And then I jumped in and I was like, why'd you even put water in this game? Like, don't even.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure the brine will kill you before the drowning kills you.
Yes, it will. Jada, we just had, speaking of like dueling things for gamers, last week was PAX and GDC at the same time. Some people worked both of them. I went to neither because I'm old and tired, but you went to GDC, which was the Game Developers Conference. Historically takes place in San Francisco, and also, like, is a really cool place for not only devs to meet up, pitch games, sell games, but also to show off the stuff they're working on. And one of my favorite things, have basically, like, theater presentations where they talk about game design. Like, some of my favorite sort of presentations I've ever seen in all of gaming have been at GDC, where you'll get, like, a classic game dev talking about how they worked on Pac-Man, or, like, here's how we did all the design, the sound design in Star Wars Battlefront, like, really cool stuff like that. So tell me about what your GDC experience was like last week.
Yeah, no, like, generally my GDC, I like to sit in as many panels. I didn't get to do any panels this year, which was really just kind of disappointing for me, just how things kind of lined up schedule-wise. But there were some really cool ones this year. There was one on Spider-Man 2's fast travel and how it almost broke the game. So, like, it wasn't almost not in the game.
I'm so glad they worked on it.
There's a bunch of stuff around Baldur's Gate 3 where they were up there talking about it. Tons of good stuff. I'm waiting for a bunch of things. They always have, like, a vault that you can access later where you can watch a bunch of videos. So I'm going to be, like, glued to that. But the folks here listening probably want to hear about the games I played. I got to play a good chunk of games. The first one that I'm really, really excited for, and it's coming out next month, I'm a big Metroidvania fan, and Tales of Kenzara is out. I finally got hands-on with this little Metroidvania darling, and it is just fantastic. It's great, it's action, it's fluid, it's, like, if you're enjoying, you know, Prince of Persia Lost Crown this year, definitely give this one a shot when it drops next month. It's got this really cool, gorgeous art style, like, great stories. The head creator was the voice actor for Bayek in Assassin's Creed Origins. Oh,
wow. Yeah, that's awesome.
So, yeah. So, like, this is his vision of a game. Like, it's just, it's gorgeous. It looks great. It plays great. There's really cool, like, I forget what it's called, but you basically swap masks and you have different abilities. So, like, you have this red mask, which is more melee focused. And then you have this blue mask that is more ranged focus. And you have, like, you know, it's kind of like Shuri from the MCU's, like, gauntlets that fire out energy blasts. But they added, he added, like, a quick reload, like, active reload, like in Gears of War. So, like, really cool, and to keep the action, like, really going, because, like, once you run out of ammo, like, with ranged in a lot of games, just like, well, I can't use ranged projectiles, you know, for a little bit. This one gives you a chance to kind of ignore that and keep going. The powers are really full, looks really fresh. I'm really excited to try this one out when that drops next month.
This looks awesome. I really love this kind of new generation of Metroidvanias that are just, like, extremely quick. Like, there's just, like, the Prince of Persia had it too. Like, this has that, like, extreme, and Metroid Dread as well, just, like, very snappy, very fast paced player control and action. And, like, this looks awesome. This is out this year?
Yeah, this is out next month.
Oh my God. April 23rd. What?
Yep.
Are you kidding? Yeah, so we're getting a bunch of really great Metroidvanias this year. I love those games so much. That rules.
Yep. I got to check out a little bit of Hyper Light Breaker. Didn't get as much time with it as I would have liked, because I'm really excited for that one. But that's kind of a good for me, because I want to go in as dark as possible for this one, because I really liked Hyper Light Drifter. Sorry.
Yeah. No, it's Breaker, okay. It's hard to keep up with these.
All these words. But yeah, so really enjoyed that one. It's very, very flashy. It's got some good combat to it. It feels great. It's like, you know, I don't want to say it's like a Metroidvania in 3D, but it's got a lot of, like, that kind of 3D, like, combat that feels good when you're just exploring the world.
Is this an open world game, or is it, like, kind of wide linear type of situation? Like,
I believe it's open world, if I remember correctly. Don't quote me on that one. I have to do a little bit more research. Like I said, I'm trying to go into this one blind because I really liked Drifter. And so, like, I've been watching a few clips here and there, but I haven't, like, done a full deep dive on this one. But this is definitely another one to keep your eyes on, I think. And this one's out this year as well, I believe.
This is
Ask, is it like the same kind of premise as Hyper Light Drifter, with, like, you know, your character being, like, terminally ill, or, like,
you know, what, I don't, you know, remember
what the setup is?
I don't remember the story setup for this one. I know it's a roguelike. It's got that roguelike elements to it, which I'm all into right now, is that roguelike type of games. Like, you know, between Bellatro and a bunch of others that have been dropping, like, that's just been my jam. But I haven't dived into the story, but this one captivated me just with its looks and flashy combat. So another one.
I mean, this is, in terms of, like, this feels like a Helldivers 2 type thing, where the original was in one perspective and the sequel is a whole new world. And, like, I think it's really cool to see that. Like, it feels like that was a pretty common thing during the N64 generation, where, like, games that were traditionally top down or 2D became 3D platformers or whatever. And so it's cool to see people take those risks. It's so easy to just go, like, we'll just do the thing that works again. But instead they're like, we're going to try a whole new dimension. So yeah, this is awesome.
And another one I want to talk about is a little game called Little Kitty, Big City. You play as this little kitten. You fall off your balcony into this big city. And your only goal is to get home. But you kind of adventure around. You meet a bunch of other characters, like a tanuki and a crow, that, you know, you give various things to, and they help you out on your journey. There's tons of side quests. You play as a cat. You hop in boxes. You knock over paint cans. If you see somebody walking with a cell phone, you can stand in front of them. They'll trip and drop their phone, and you can take their phone from them and run, and they'll chase you.
Why does he need a phone?
He doesn't, but he doesn't want the person to have it. So that's all that matters. Yeah, there you go. But yeah, this one's fun. I think this will be cool for, you know, very cozy kind of game that people will get into.
I like this.
I played a bunch of other things. I won't be able to talk a lot of them. I played Angerfoot, where you go around kicking things. I kicked a helicopter to death on the top of a rooftop. That was fun. I played Dungeons of Hinterburg, which has got a little bit of that social element for, like, Persona, if you like that. But it's also got dungeon crawling during the day, where you're going through beating up a bunch of things and some pretty clever puzzles. Sinking City 2. Brian, I think you might be interested in this one. The first one was very kind of, like, Cthulhu and investigation stuff, but this one they've kind of flipped the gameplay to be more survival horror. Like a la Resident Evil 4, Silent Hill Remake. It's going more that avenue, and it still has the detective stuff in there that you can do, but it's not required now. It's more optional, but it gives you a lot of benefits and stuff to doing that. So
yeah, I'm all
definitely
over this.
Definitely one to keep in your horizons. And yeah, and then the last one I'll talk about for GDC is Luna Abyss, and this was kind of my kind of game. It's a mixture of like Metroid Prime and Doom, like Doom. Ooh. 2016, I think it was that one. Doom, yeah. 2016, Doom Eternal. It's got that very fast, hectic, chaotic. It's very eerie, very creepy. But it's got like the lock on for like locking onto enemies and tapping between enemies to like blow them up with your rifle or shotgun. Very cool. Very like, I don't know too much about the story yet, but really enjoyed the aesthetic of the game and the gameplay. Just very, very good.
Hell yeah. Real quick, did any of you notice somebody made a mod for Returnal on PC where you can play as Samus from Metroid?
Mm-hmm. Oh,
I saw that on Twitter.
Who's ever out, I love you for just thank yes. you. Thank you to modders. You. Like you just yes. really doing the Lord's work for free. Just amazing, amazing work. I can't wait to try that.
The last thing I'll say about GDC, they also always do this cool thing called Alt.CTRL.GDC, which is a bunch of really weird, wacky controllers. One of the big ones that was there, it took, like everybody was posting about, was this waffle maker game where you basically play with a waffle maker and you're slamming the waffle maker up and down nonstop. And like you're pouring batter with like a half bottle, like plastic bottle of water, like to yeah. pour the batter. And you have one singular arcade button that you're pressing. So there's that. There was one where you sit on a toilet. There was one called Get Off My Lawn, where you sit in a lawn chair with a water hose and you spray kids on the screen to get them off your lawn. And there even had like a beer can that you could like lift up. I think it was for like recharging your stamina or something. It was right. Just great. Just tons
and you
of stuff.
Can, if you want to play that one, you can go outside and try that right now. Just yeah. you know, give it a shot. Just
if you've got a patio.
Yeah. Spray children. And if you want to play the waffle game, check out the Holiday Inn Express buffet breakfast.
Yeah, there
they
you
love
go.
It. They love it when you go there and slam the waffle maker up and down.
But yeah, Alt.CTRL GDC. It's amazing.
I love how we just took like mundane retail jobs and turned them into like video games. I'll never get over that. Last but not least, IGN launched a brand new show this week. It's out right now. It's called Game of the Year Watch. It's right now we're on the hook. We're going to do four of them, I think. We're going to do quarterly, right? So every 4 months. And or no, every 3 months. Am I wrong?
Every 3 months.
Every 3 months. Wow, it's been a long one. And so yeah, we basically looked at all of the best reviewed games that we've covered so far this year. Some of you might have actually reviewed them. And we put them against each other in a very special episode called Game of the Year Watch. Jada, you get to be on that. How did it
yeah,
go?
Yeah, it went great. You know, we got to like sit down and kind of like weigh the pros and cons of a bunch of different games. Right now, our top contenders were Balatro, Prince of Persia, The Lost Crown, Final Fantasy VII Rebirth, Pal World, Helldivers 2, Tekken 8, Persona 3 Reload, and Like a Dragon, Infinite Wealth, and Unicorn Overlord. Those were...
Yes.
I didn't either, actually. But I've played basically all of them, which is why they wanted me on there. Plus, I'm community lead, so like I get... I'm watching all the polls for our community. Like our community picked Helldivers 2 was their big for on social at least, and I believe on site I believe number one is Rebirth. I believe it was Rebirth was number one. The one thing I will say about that show, I didn't get to talk enough about Tekken 8. I love Tekken 8. It's so good. I just know how much of an uphill battle it is for a fighting game to win a overall Game of the Year award.
It's tough
every yeah. year. Like fighting games are great. They're fantastic. They're a staple of the industry, but like they're also, I'd say, have some of the smaller audiences or like the smallest like section of the audience that people that dedicate a lot of time to them compared to RPGs or open world games yep. or action games or FPSs.
One of the reasons I really like this show is I feel like when we just do the Game of the Year discussion in December, there's sort of inherently a recency bias, right? Like invariably we talk a lot about the games that launched in the fall. Last year, like Baldur's Gate 3 was like at the top of everybody's list because we were just so obsessed with it. It had released recently. Tears of the Kingdom somehow came through and won. I think that people, like, maybe more people at IGN played it, or like it connected with more people more significantly, whatever it is. But doing a show like this quarterly gives you a chance to sort of sit down and say, like, hey, let's look at the yearbook before the year is over, right? Like, let's actually, like, Tekken 8, I don't think would have been in the conversation, or Prince of Persia or something like that. But right now we can look at those games and be like, hell yeah, that's actually a pretty, like, they're strong contenders for some of our favorite games of the year so far. So yeah, we're going to check back in a couple more times this year. Go check out Game of the Year Watch on IGN.com and YouTube right now. Leave your favorite game in the comments. Yell at the hosts for the wrong things they said about your favorite games, or the
leave nice things, please.
Yell at the host nicely. Jada's like, yes. I have to look at those comments.
I have to look at those comments.
To the people who make things here.
And for those yelling, we didn't talk a whole lot about Dragon's Dogma or Rise of the Ronin because they were so new when we were recording that those will be in the next. That'll be in the next chapter that we'll be doing in the summer. So
yeah, they're also not as good as Like a Dragon. So it's okay.
it's my current forerunner for no, game of the year.
Me too. But yeah, that just about wraps us up for Beyond. Jada, Mitchell, thank you both so much for joining me today to yell about a bunch of video games that we love that we're playing right now. It's my favorite thing is when we get to just, like, when great new games are out, we're not just like, hey, there's an update 68.4 to PS5, and you know what it does? It makes the light a little dimmer. Thanks for watching. No, I obviously that stuff's important, but like I love to play video games and talk about them, so getting to do that with people that I genuinely love and respect is my favorite thing in the world. So thank you so much for joining me. Wish well to Max. He has been throwing up in a circle nonstop for 6 days straight. It's almost out, it's almost done, but as soon as that's done, he'll be back hosting the show and you won't have to look at me anymore. Well, you will. I'll just be one rectangle over. Beyond.
Yeah. Beyond.